I bought a toothbrush, some toothpaste, a flannel for my face, pajamas, a hairbrush, new shoes and a case. I'm going to Butlin's. Good evening, everyone. I hope you're all well. Thank you so, so much for having me. Thank you all for being out here this evening. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name is Tom Crowley. That's been well established. I am 30 years old. I'm right-handed. I'm not really interested in sport. And 90% of the meals I eat are some variation of the sandwich. I have come down here from London, where I live, especially for this show. Don't feel you have to clap. I understand we have some people here from London. Give us a cheer. Yay! Give us a cheer if you've ever been to London. Fantastic. I absolutely love London. I was born there. I've lived there my whole life. I still live there now. I absolutely adore it. People say to me, Tom, everything moves very quickly in London. It's all very fast-paced and stressful. It's very smelly and polluted as well. And everyone's very poor and angry all the time. And when you're on the tube and you look into the eyes of your fellow passengers, you can tell deep down that at the merest provocation, they would kill and eat you. And I say, yeah, it's great, isn't it? I know. Wonderful. I credit living in London with the fact that I've never got into, like, crack cocaine or speed or something, because I get all of the blood-pumping adrenaline rush I need from going to get some milk. You go in the shop, can you stay back? That is my semi-skimmed organic. You stay away. Yeah, give me an excuse. Any excuse. Any excuse, you toilet. Come at me. Okay. That's the attitude. Okay, now pass me those Jaffa cakes. Yeah, that's right. Nice and slow. Sorry? No, I don't have a Nectar card. No. Wanna make something of it? So it's nice to come down here to Oxford for a little break from that. I've been traveling around a fair bit of the rest of the country recently. Oxford's a wonderful place to be. I always love coming down here. Last weekend I went to Buxton. Any fans of Buxton in Derbyshire? Yeah, oh, a couple of... Rah, rah, rah. Yeah, quite. That's quite right. Buxton is a wonderful place, a very, very kind of pleasant, sleepy, beautiful kind of little village. 364 days of the year. Last Saturday was the Buxton Carnival. Sounds nice, doesn't it? So I was up there to visit the Buxton Fringe. As it happened, the carnival also fell on the same day. So I get off the train and I'm walking through town. It's like, oh, what a beautiful tea shop and pub and an old Victorian sort of shopping arcade. That's very nice. And then I got more into the centre of town. And are they putting up like fairground rides and things? That's so nice. I imagine the kids having a nice time on that. And then go to the bed and breakfast, check in, drop my bags, come back out again. And oh, wonderful, it's all kicking off. All the fairground rides are all turned on. All the families wandering around, going on the rides and things. Everyone's got an ice cream. It's all so nice, so, so lovely. And the pumping techno coming out of the carnival rides has only made me deaf in one out of two ears. So it's still quite a nice weekend. It's all going very well. But then things sort of wind down for the fun fair element. And the families all kind of wander off. And then the purge begins. For 12 hours, one day a year, the people of Buxton unleash all of the anger and frustration they've been building up all that time in a carnival of underage drinking. You will see 14-year-olds projectile vomiting into elaborately sculpted topiary swans after four cans of Polish beer. You will see young people rubbing up against each other behind the skips, attempting to achieve penetration through two pairs of skinny jeans. You will see grown women in 6-inch heels crumpled in shop doorways, openly weeping and screaming, "He's a bastard!" The Purge, Derbyshire. £4 for a go on the dadgems. But the Sunday was nice. I shouldn't be that surprised, because being from London, London has quite a strained relationship with the rest of England. You can tell that from any sort of population breakdown, from polls, news coverage, you know, any sort of social study. There's a real split there. And the accusation always is that people from London don't really know anything about England outside of London, and that they don't understand England outside of London. And I think, no flipping surprise, because has anyone actually been to the West Midlands? Have you? Has anyone been to the West Midlands? Have you? Well, I haven't, but you know what it's like. You've seen it on telly, like the news and things. You see, you know how it is. It's just this kind of barren wasteland with like ashen and grey and dull. Whole towns with nothing but a post office and a single disused phone booth with a sheep in there just worrying the cord over days and weeks. And then the, outside the town, the horizon, nothing, a flat, barren wasteland with only a single dead tree in the distance to break it up. And all the people in the town, they get up every morning and they look out there and they say, we'll go to that tree one day, and they never do. And there's people, these confused people, just wandering around, no idea where they're going, bumping into things, just having these conversations like, you know, oh, ow, oh, oh, ow, oh, hello, 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 Brian. All right, Steve, mate, how are you? I'm all right, thanks, Brian, actually. I'm tremendously well. How are you? Well, Steve, actually, it's quite exciting. I've got myself a new pet, actually. Oh, is that right, Brian? That's nice. What sort of pet have you got for yourself? I've gone and got myself a pet basilisk, actually. Oh, yes. Is that the mythological lizard of legend and fable? It is, actually. Yeah. Is that the one which goes around and round and swallows its own tail, symbolising infinity? No, actually, that's the Ouroboros you're thinking of. It's the Ouroboros that goes all round, symbolising it. Oh, yes, it is, sorry. Well, all right then. In fact, the basilisk is a much smaller creature. Famously, it's no more than 12 fingers long. Oh, well, that must be a bit more manageable to look after. But yes, you'd think so, wouldn't you? But I got him down the Marquis, and what they don't tell you is that it can kill with a glance. So I can't even look at him, my new pet basilisk. Well, that's very galling, actually, Brian. And the other thing that they don't tell you at the market is that the basilisk cannot abide the stench of the weasel. He'll die if he smells a weasel. That really is awfully inconvenient, Brian, because as you well know, there's loads of weasels around here. And if I'm not mistaken, your wife is in fact the president of the Hales Owen Weasel Appreciation Society. She is, and I'll tell you what though, they're not having any more meetings around my house. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Ha ha, so you're still campaigning for a hard Brexit then? Oh yes, absolutely, definitely. Crush the saboteurs and all that. Oh dear. Baffling people, quite frankly. Baffling. I mean, could you understand any of that? Because I couldn't. But I don't want to try and get too political this evening, ladies and gentlemen, because there's an ongoing conversation in comedy at the moment, you may not be aware, but people are quite irked that comedy's very left-wing overall. I think it's pretty clear if you see enough shows. Comedy generally is considerably left-wing. And people are sort of complaining that there's no right-wing counter-narrative in comedy. Because there's so many left-wing comedians, why shouldn't you have some more right-wing comedians? People say there aren't enough right-wing comedians around. And I'll tell you why. It's because there aren't enough rich comedians. Which is why I've begun a new campaign. If every person in this theatre put £100 in my hand before we leave this building here tonight, we could create a brand new, selfish, entitled, right-wing comedian right here and right now. We can create a new Tom Crowley. Not the pinko bearded milquetoast you see before you now, no. But a Tom Crowley who is prepared to make jokes about disabled people getting everything for free, even though disabled access to benefits has been slashed across the last 5 years. A Tom Crowley who is prepared to make snide comments about immigration and people of different ethnicities to himself, even though it's not 1951. A Tom Crowley who thinks the Me Too movement is just a pack of joyless lesbians in need of a good rogering. A Tom Crowley, who will finally be booked on Have I Got News For You in the interests of BBC balance. This is the Tom Crowley the nation is crying out for. And all it will take is a six-figure income and a four-bedroom house in Kent to make it come true. So this is my plea to you here tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Make comedians wealthy. and make comedy awful again. I thank you. If I've achieved nothing else here tonight, ladies and gents, I've ensured that nobody will pay me any money for doing anything ever again. You're welcome, Mum. I finally did it. And I'm afraid I'll have to leave you very shortly. I'm so sorry to say that. We'll get on, but we will be getting on with the main body of the show, which we've all been waiting for. I'm very excited about that myself. But if you'll indulge me. Before that, I think we've got time for one last song. Echoing tonight, she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight. Her moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide me towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient melodies. He turned to me as if to say, "Hurry, boy, it's waiting there for you." I'm going to Butlins. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Oxford. You've been wonderful.